All right, good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for being here. Joining me are Commissioner Brandy Canazzi, Chief Engagement Officer in the Mayor's Office, Nubia Willman, as well as OEMC Interim Director Jose Tirado. As many of you know, since August of 2022, our city has responded to the arrival of approximately 8,000 asylum seekers, individuals and families coming to Chicago, most after being inhumanely and dangerously bused here by Texas Governor Greg Abbott. This was done with little advance notice, no coordination, and simply no consideration for our ability to receive these arrivals in a safe, orderly, and dignified way. Last week, I sent a letter to Governor Abbott when we learned that he may be sending more migrants to our city via bus, to try to reason and explain to him that, yes, of course, we are a welcoming city, and we will always do what is right by our immigrant and refugee communities. But we've reached a breaking point in our response to this humanitarian crisis, primarily manufactured by him for cynical political purposes. As expected, my letter was written in vain. And today we responded to the arrival of 48 more individuals and families that required emergency support and shelter, shipped here by Governor Abbott from Texas. As sympathetic as we are to the significant challenges that border cities face now and have been facing for quite some time, Chicago simply does not have the infrastructure or resources to continue humanely providing for migrants. Both our pre-existing facilities and newly created facilities are full. I explained this to the governor, who ignored this reality, all to burnish his right-wing credentials as he fades into irrelevancy with the upcoming presidential cycle. Hundreds of migrants are temporarily staying in police stations while they await more appropriate housing. This crisis is not only exhausting our city's resources, but it's flat out dangerous for the individuals and families who have been wrapped up in this political stunt. Sadly, we don't expect the buses to stop arriving anytime soon. And importantly, we've seen in the last couple weeks a new surge in migrants coming to Chicago on a daily basis. And that is why today I have issued a declaration of emergency to bolster our response to the arrival of the migrants. This declaration empowers the city's chief procurement officer to exercise the purchasing authority set forth in the municipal code to adequately address this declared emergency. It also directs all city departments to undertake whatever efforts are feasible and necessary pursuant to their powers to assist in the management of this declared emergency. We shouldn't have to come to this point, but here we are. And even in my final days as mayor, it's important for us to step up and respond to this burgeoning crisis. I continue to be proud of our city as a welcoming city. It's easy but difficult to do, and Chicago will always rise to the challenges. We have always been a beacon of hope and a welcoming place for immigrants and refugees since our earliest days, and we will always be so. As we take this step and respond to the continued influx of new arrivals, we'll also continue calling upon the federal government for much-needed support and policy changes. Our immigration challenges are great as a nation. There's no doubt about that. But the burden cannot rest on one city alone. Nor should one individual usurp and undermine the federal authority and prerogatives and create national policy on an issue as complex as the immigration system and dealing with asylum seekers, which is essentially what is happening now. We need a national solution for this national challenge. This can't be done city by city, state by state. It's got to be comprehensive, and it's got to be originated by the federal government to address and solve this challenge. Immigrants and refugees, the mothers and fathers and elders and kids of all ages that we've welcomed to our city, they only came to the U.S. in search of a better life and safety. It's downright un-American to treat these people with such disregard and disrespect the way that Governor Abbott has, and it's certainly not the Chicago way. I also want to send a message to the NGOs who are involved in the important work of attending to the needs of asylum seekers at the border. Let me be clear. While your work is important, you do not help migrants by sending them to cities like Chicago, where we have no more ability to help these newcomers and where people you send have no sponsors or families here. It's simply the wrong approach and further aggravates an already traumatic set of circumstances. And I will again repeat that the federal government simply must expedite legal work permits for the people that are here. These asylum seekers must have the ability to work legally, to support themselves and their families. Employers are eager to hire able-bodied adults today, but can't do it legally without federal action. And we call upon the federal government to take that action with all deliberate speed. I stand ready to work and collaborate on solutions that do not involve the unilateral, chaotic busing of people to our doorsteps or placing the burden of solving this national crisis solely on the shoulders of cities like Chicago. Until then, the city will continue living our values, doing the best that we can under these very difficult circumstances. I'm happy to take your questions.
Members of the media, Stephen and I will be passing down the mic. One question to a reporter because of the mayor's schedule, she has to leave shortly. So we're going to pick it off with Evelyn, ABC 7. We'll go down.
Good afternoon, Mayor. What does this actually look like? What kind of money are you anticipating from the feds, from the state? How does this work? What's the plan?
Well, we do have a plan. We do have an infrastructure. We've been planning for a surge now for weeks. You are aware that May 11th is when Title 42 will go away. We've been anticipating a new wave of migrants coming to our city, but frankly, we started seeing it about 10 days, 2 weeks ago. We went from a fairly stable population of migrants to seeing now 100, 200 on a daily basis. So we are doing everything that we can. We're looking at every available resource, but we need more money from the federal government. The money that we just received from FEMA that was announced in the last few days is less than what we got last fall when, yes, we were in a crisis, but it's worse now, and it's going to get worse before it gets better. So the federal government has got to be sending resources, real resources, to cities like Chicago. And frankly, it's a slap in the face of cities like Chicago, New York, D.C., Denver, Philly, Albuquerque, who are now shouldering more and more of this challenge of migrants and asylum seekers coming inland to send more money to the border when they're using those dollars to send migrants to our cities. That has to stop.
Mayor, in the declaration, it said that you reserve the right to reach out to the governor to bring in the National Guard. Did you make that request, or has there been any outreach to the governor's office? And
yeah, I've been personally in conversation with the governor, and our teams are in regular conversations really since last fall. I want to commend the governor and his team for stepping up and helping, but there may reach a point where we do need further assistance in the form of the National Guard, which is why I highlighted that in the declaration. We're not there yet, but staffing is the biggest expense that we are facing and the biggest challenge that we are seeing on the horizon, of course, in addition to finding sufficient and adequate space to house the migrants and asylum seekers who are coming here.
Carmen.
Good afternoon, Mayor.
Good afternoon.
So as of now, how many shelters are you planning to open, or how many shelters are you able to open?
Well, we are running out of space, as I've indicated. When we first started seeing the surge of asylum seekers last fall, we did a complete inventory of available spaces. And to be clear, they've got to be spaces that are habitable, meaning they have to have, when we were talking about shelters, they have to have places for people to be able to stay 24/7. They've got to have showers, bathrooms, and places for us to bring in hot meals. We're now opening up respite centers those also have to have the basic services there. So people say, well, there's plenty of a vacant space across the city, but we need large spaces that we can accommodate hundreds of folks at a time to make it efficient for us with our staffing needs. But we also have to have spaces that aren't completely gutted and have none of the infrastructure inside that we will need to be able to accommodate these asylum seekers in a humane fashion. Correct. So I can't tell you right now because we don't know what the number is going to be. We have plans, as I said, in place for a surge, but the surge is going to be aggravated if Governor Abbott continues unabated to ship by busloads here while the federal government is providing money at the border. It doesn't make any sense. He's violating basic humanity of these asylum seekers. I think he's involved in a conspiracy of corruption in the fact that he is unwilling to see the humanity and the trauma that these migrants have faced on their journey from their home countries to the United States, and just sticking them on buses where they don't have sponsors, where they don't have a family network, doesn't make any sense.
Chris Todd, CBS.
If I could just follow up on that question, how many shelters do we have right now?
Let Commissioner Kanazi answer that.
We currently have 7 shelters and 3 respite centers.
7?
7.
You can get one more. It looks like you had one more question.
I'm trying to get an answer there. Mayor, can you also speak to any communication you've had with Brandon Johnson's team about this? You're talking about the spike is continuing. It will then be his job. Can you speak at all about the transition that's been going on along these lines?
Yeah, we've been briefing the Mayor-elect's team all along. We've had several substantive briefings in the last couple weeks because, as you know, as of Monday, he assumes the mantle of being the mayor of the city. His team is going to own responsibility for this. So we wanted to make sure, and we will continue to be in contact with them to make sure that they are fully up to speed on the latest information that we have to help them take over responsibility for this continuing crisis.
Easy.
Hi, Mayor.
Hi there.
Somewhat on that note, you know, obviously the Budget Committee just approved $50 million, but your budget director described quite a fiscal cliff by the end of June, saying those dollars are going to run out and there are going to be hard decisions that need to be made. What options are available to your successor if the competitive federal grant dollars that the city's, you know, planning to apply for don't come through? Should Mr. Johnson consider dipping into, you know, advanced pension payment funds, for instance, or what options are really going to be available to him if federal dollars don't come
through? Well, look, I don't want to speculate about that. My hope is that the federal dollars will come through. We're working with our entire delegation, and including our 2 senators, to make the case. I want to commend in particular Representative Quigley and Representative Kelly, who I've personally been in contact with and are making the case for us. So I'm going to be optimistic and hope that people in Washington will wake up to the reality of what's happening in cities like Chicago, and we're going to keep fighting that fight. Look, we want to make sure, part of the reason we asked for monies to take us through the end of June is to give the mayor-elect and his team the ability to really get their arms around the circumstances and really understand in great detail. We wanted to give them breathing room to be able to do that. But yes, this issue is going to come up again in the not-too-distant future.
What about the suggestion from Alderman Haddon that you use McCormick Place or Navy Pier or some of the shuttered big box stores to get people out of the police stations? And also, why aren't people in police stations being fed?
Well, first of all, I'm not aware of anybody not being fed. We are doing everything that we can to make their stay there as short as possible, which is why we're looking at other alternatives, respite places in particular, and opening up other beds throughout our shelter system. But secondly, it doesn't make any sense to shut down McCormick Place and Navy Pier that are huge economic drivers in the city that have conventions and meetings already booked out through next year. That's just simply not a viable option, and I'm not sure why that was put on the table. We can't disrupt the flow of business at McCormick Place and at Navy Pier to solve this challenge. We've looked at every available big box store. As I've said, it's not simply just a matter of space. It's a matter of space where we can manage a population humanely. We're not just warehousing people. We're not going to treat them in the same that we've seen Governor Abbott do without any regard for their humanity. We've got to put them in places where they can have respite, where they can go to the bathroom, where they can have shower, where there's the possibility of a hot meal. And in many instances of the inventory of vacant places that we've looked at, hundreds really, over the course of time, there are very few that fit the criteria that are needed to be able to accommodate these migrants in a way that we believe is fitting with their humanity and fitting with our role as a welcoming city.
Hi, Mayor. One of the components of the emergency declaration gives the chief procurement officer emergency purchasing power. Mm-hmm. Is there anything set up so far in line of that, or what kind of needs do you or, you know, the people standing behind you anticipate through that portion of the order?
Well, I mean, the first thing is making sure that we continue and expand our staffing capabilities to accommodate these various shelters and respite centers that we're setting up. That's the first order of business on an emergency basis that the chief procurement officer will exercise her authority to address.
Hi, Mayor. So as of now, those families at the police stations will have to remain there. Is there a timeline?
We're trying to move them out as expeditiously as we possibly can. It is not appropriate for them to be at police stations, because what we're seeing is not just singles, but families with children. That's why we have been saying now for quite some time, we don't have any more space. I cannot emphasize that enough. And we can't live in a perpetual cycle of people coming in from cities in Texas with one-way plane tickets to Chicago, where they don't have sponsors, where they don't have a family network, and then ending up at our police station. That is not the way to go.
And then just really quickly, aside from food, are they being provided health screenings at all?
Yes, they are. That should, of course, be happening at the border. That should not be our responsibility. But we have, from the very beginning, made sure in partnership with Cook County that we're providing people with the health screenings that are necessary. I think we're going to Craig Delamore, Fran.
Mayor, as your Commissioner Kanazi heard at the hearing that was just held, there are some aldermen, there are some people in the public who fear that the kind of aid, extra aid, that they're seeing now going to the new arrivals is coming at the expense of already overtaxed services within the city itself, for the homeless, for poor people. What can you say to assure them that they are not, that the sacrifice isn't going to be shared by people who are already having troubles?
Yeah, I've heard people say that, and I will remind aldermen of the budgets that they vote for, of the services that we provide at historic levels in many instances, whether it's to the homeless, whether it's affordable housing, whether support for youth, the environment. We're not short-circuiting anyone. We are doing what we need to do. We're making sure that we fulfill the commitments that were made as part of our budgets. We're executing on those with fidelity. And the members that are saying that, I'm going to send them a copy of the budget book and remind them what they voted for, because we are executing on the commitments that were made in the various appropriations just last year and the year before. And we report regularly to the City Council on how we're doing, how those monies are being spent. So I understand the concern. Some of it is rhetoric, but the reality is that we are executing on the appropriations authority that the City Council has given us, and we report in on a regular basis with fidelity and transparency about what those are. So I don't want anybody to leave here today, anybody within the sound of my voice, thinking that somehow we're short-circuiting Chicagoans, because we are simply not.
Hi. Has President Biden or anyone from his administration given you any direct response to your request for federal assistance?
That's an interesting question. What I will say is this. We have had lots of dialogue, but I'm disappointed in the allocation of FEMA dollars that we just got and that was announced last week. We got $5.5 million last fall. We got just over $4 million this time. That doesn't make any sense to me. And we have made our disappointment known through the appropriate channels, but I'm calling upon the federal government to solve this problem. And I'll emphasize again, if we could put people to work legally, it would lessen the strain on all of our resources. When there's no outflow from our shelters because folks can't work legally, that presents a huge challenge, not just here in Chicago, but all across the nation, all the cities like Chicago that have seen this influx of migrants coming to our cities. We need to be able to get them to work. As you know, there's a shortage of employees all across the nation. Chicago's no different. I am confident that we could put to work every able-bodied adult if they had work permits and we were able to do so legally. This is something that I have been talking about with anyone who will listen in the federal government, from the Labor Secretary to the Homeland Security Secretary, the head of Customs and Border Patrol, of course, folks in the White House. They have got to act with all deliberate speed to issue work permits to the people who are already here so that we can lessen the burden. If they're able to go out and work and take care of themselves and pay for housing, it will solve a lot of the challenges that we are seeing. It's not happening with the kind of speed that is necessary given the crisis that we are all facing.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
Yes, can I ask one thing? You have always been so reluctant to ask the National Guard.
That's a wrap, everyone.
Under what circumstances would you use the National Guard and call them out?
Well, I'm reluctant under the National Guard, and we've talked about it in entirely different circumstances. The circumstances here would be for them to come in and help support with staffing and with logistics. We're not at that point yet, and the National Guard is not a panacea. Many people think, call out the National Guard. It's not a panacea. They have limited abilities. They have limited durations of time that they can be in a place. It's a resource that is available, but we've got to use that resource wisely, and it's not going to solve the challenge in the long term. Maybe we get 30, 40 people for a short period of time. Keep in mind the National Guard are people that have other lives, other jobs, that they are primarily volunteers, sometimes on a full-time basis, but it's not a long-term solution. So if I need to do that, certainly I wouldn't hesitate to do it. I've done it in the past under different circumstances, but it's not a panacea. Thank you all.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.